important part of your preparation for the board exams. It is a major area, fundamentals of property ownership, and in the practice of real estate, this is one of those areas that any real estate practitioner should be well aware of, or even should attain some form of yung mastery. So as the title of this presentation is being presented, it's fundamentals, no, of property ownership. There are other more complicated aspects, discussions on property ownership, but for our purposes, we'll cover only those fundamentals which we think will be necessary, no, for you to hurdle questions during the board exams, as well as some to provide you with some working knowledge in the practice of your profession later. So let's go over quickly the definition of property under Article 414 of the Civil Code. So property here is being defined in the generic sense as all things which are or may be object of appropriation. To take note of the word appropriation, now anything that is can be the object of appropriation is property. So the elements of property, they are: number one, utility. It's capability of the thing to satisfy a human need. Second, substantiality, independent existence. And third is appropriability, susceptibility to ownership. So you have three elements of utility: substantiality and appropriability. Now for our course, we're more interested on one type of property. No, this is the real or immovable property under Article 415 of the Civil Code. And when you talk about immovable property, they are categorized into different groupings. No, by first, by nature, or by nature, or by the nature of the property itself, you have what is the most common one is land, and you have roads, mines, and quarries, wells, and sewers. So take note the other types of classification or identification of property by nature. No, wells, sewers. These were terms used when the Civil Code was crafted during the early 1900. No, so if this property is included, no, if your property is included in this enumeration, they are by nature immovable property. Then you have by incorporation, no, such as buildings or constructions, we call them improvements, no, on the land, anything that is adhered to the soil, and in general those which are attached to an immovable in a fixed manner. So they are also called real property under paragraphs 1 to 3 of Article 415 of the Civil Code, regardless of the ownership thereof. And third is by analogy, such as real rights over immovable property under paragraph 10 of Article 415 of the Civil Code. You have real property by destination. These are objects for use or on ornamentation placed in buildings or on lands by the owner of the immovable or his agent in such a manner that it reveals the intention to attach permanently thereto. Kasama na dyan yung mga machinery, other implements intended by the owner of the tenement for an industry or work. The first na part yan, for example, the intention is really, for example, you place some form of artwork in the buildings, that artwork will become real property by destination. The second part, you have machinery, implements intended by the owner or of the tenement for an industry or work. You have, for example, heavy equipment. The intention is this machinery equipment will perform some industrial work in that building, and which tend directly to meet the needs of said industrial work by virtue of paragraphs 4 to 7 and 9 of Article 415 of the Civil Code. they are real property by destination. Now, the main provision under the Civil Code on modes of acquiring property is found under Article 712. It states that ownership is acquired by occupation and by intellectual creation. Ownership and other real rights over property are acquired and transmitted by law, number one, by donation, third, by estate and intestate succession, and in consequence of certain contracts by tradition. So when you say tradition, by delivery. Okay, let's just quickly dissect Article 712 of the Civil Code. It summarizes various modes of acquiring ownership of property. The first paragraph of that article states the first two are by occupation. And second is by intellectual creation. Yung mga ginagawa ng mga, for example, writers, no, yung mga singers, yung mga sinusulat nila, those are, once they publish it, or even produce it, creates a right over this type of property. Then the second paragraph of that Article 712 states that ownership and other real rights over property are acquired and transmitted by, third, by law, no, then third, by donation, fourth, by estate and intestate succession, and fifth, in consequence of certain contracts by tradition. Yung pang-apat, estate and intestate succession. Now, if you have estate, succession by virtue of will, intestate, walang last will and testament. Donation is self-explanatory na to. So last paragraph of Article 712 states that ownership may also be acquired by means of prescription, no? So for example, several years ka na dyan, no, over the property, it creates the certain right on you to say that you're the owner, no, by prescription, by lapse of time, ibig sabihin ng prescription. Occupation, ano ibig sabihin ng occupation? Under Article 713, quickly, things appropriable by nature which are without an owner, yung walang may-ari, no? Such as animals that are object of hunting and fishing, hidden treasure, and abandoned movables are acquired by occupation. Sa kagubatan ka, nag-hunting ka ng mga mga animals, so di ba, nag-fish ka, so nakuha mo yan, you become a property by occupation. Di ba, nakakuha ka ng hidden treasure. No, there are certain provisions, special provisions under the law, but generally, kung nakuha mo yan, you become the property. Or abandoned movables, yung mga naiwan ng mga gamit. 714, ownership of piece of land cannot be acquired by occupation. Now, take note of Article 714, yung piece of land cannot be acquired by mere occupation. Dapat it should be in tandem with other provision of law. No, for example, prescription, no, occupy ka, pinoses mo, then so over a certain period of time, no, na you have taken possession, occupation, as long as hindi siya covered ng other provisions of law, no, or even a torrent system. Quickly lang to intellectual creation, other persons, yung mga author na mention ko sa kanina, no, yung composer, yung painter, yung scientist, no? They acquire property by intellectual creation. Then donation, no, as defined under Article 725, this is an act of liberality whereby a person disposes gratuitously of a thing or right in favor of another who accepts it. No? So gratuitous, no, walang consideration. Binigay mo sa another person, that is what you call donation under Article 725. Succession, Article 774, a mode of acquisition by virtue of which the property, rights, and obligations to the extent of the value of the inheritance of a person are transmitted through his death to another or others either by will or by operation of law. No? So kung will, testate succession yan. By operation of law, walang last will and testament, you have intestate succession. So merong mga procedures dyan, no? Mga rights, mga heirs to property, including yung sharing nila. Then quickly, prescription, no? Under Article 1106, when you say prescription, one acquires ownership and other real rights through the lapse of time. No, lumampas yung panahon, you have ordinary prescription at 10 years, then extraordinary 30 years. Okay, so that is what you call prescription. Then let's go quickly. Now as a review, property relations between husband and wife under Article 74, no, of the Family Code. The property relationship between husband and wife shall be governed in the following order. Now, order number one, by marriage settlements executed before the marriage. Take note, class, no, of the word before the marriage. If you have marriage settlement, that should be executed by the parties before their marriage. No, hindi pwedeng after. And another term for marriage settlement is, anybody? Anong other ano to, anong ginagawa, common
prenup. Common
prenup, no, prenup. So who said this? Sino sabi nito? Si Ms. Ubales, no, kakakasal lang siguro to ni Ms. Ubales kasi alam niya, no, tinatawag na prenup, no, prenuptial agreement. So yung legal, the more technical term is marriage settlement. Then pangalawa, by provisions of this code. Then by local custom. Yung pangatlo, local custom, no, in the absence of yung provisions, no, ng civil code. But normally covered naman, no, ng provisions ng civil code natin. So that is that always yung order. Before yung provisions of this code, no, will govern the agreement between the ano to, yung parties will be given priority under their marriage settlement. So what are the property relations, no, between husband and wife, no, quickly lang to because this will be review. Number one, you have absolute community. Number two, conjugal partnership gains. Number three, complete separation of property. Then hindi lang malimit yan. It could be some combination of these three property regimes or any other regime. No, any other property relation that the husband and wife may agree. So in the absence of a marriage settlement, kung walang marriage settlement, that is almost 99% of all marriages in the Philippines, wala namang prenup. No, kasi mga prenup, kanyan, no, usong-uso yan sa mga sobrang yaman. No, or may mga issues, no, so, but it's quite ill yan, no, sa Filipino culture. Normally walang marriage settlement dito sa Pilipinas na ginagawa, no, except for those na very rich talaga, or when the regime agreed upon is void, the system of absolute community of property as established in this code shall govern. Ibig sabihin, ang kung walang marriage settlement, ang property relations ng mag-asawa will be the system of absolute community of property. We'll discuss that, no? Anong ibig sabihin niyan? So ito yung system of absolute community under Article 91 of the Family Code. When you have yung absolute community of property, it shall consist of all the property owned by the spouses at the time of the celebration of marriage or acquired thereafter. So lahat ng mga dinala na ano to, na under certain exceptions, no, we'll be discussing later, or those properties acquired by the spouses during the celebration of marriage or after, will be considered as absolute community. No, so ang common na ano to, understanding yan is anong property ni Mr., property ni Mrs., property ni Mrs., property ni Mr. No, ganun yan, absolute community. Ang hindi kasama sa absolute community under Article 92 of the Family Code, yung property acquired during marriage by gratuitous title by either spouse. No? When you say gratuitous title, kasama na yung donation, ibigay sa kanya. As, and the fruits as well as the income thereof, if any, unless it is expressly provided by the donor. testator or grantor that they shall form part of the community property. Okay, may dinonate, may binigay sa isang asawa sa one of the parties, hindi kasama yan sa absolute community unless the donor expressly no state that that should form part of the community property. Hindi kasama din sa ano to community property yung personal at saka mga property for personal at saka exclusive use of either spouse. Yung mga jewelry, yung mga exclusive property pala na rather. Pero yung jewelry shall form part of the community property. The third, property acquired before the marriage by either spouse who has legitimate descendants by a former marriage. No, yung second na mga ano to, partnership, merong mga descendants. No, yung ano to, yung spouse, hindi kasama yan. No, by provision, by the third paragraph, Article 92. The fruits as well as the income, if any, of such property. So, for example, yung mag-asawa, namatay yung, for example, namatay si Mrs., nagkinasal si Mr., yung mga property na acquire no ng mag-asawa if they have legitimate descendants no kung may mga anak sila or mga descendants hindi kasama yan sa absolute community ng second marriage. Presumption, the presumption always that the property should belong to the absolute community unless kasama sa mga exclusions, no? So that's the presumption under the civil code. Anything that is acquired during marriage is presumed to form part of absolute community. Then let's quickly go sa conjugal partnership gains. Ano to? Under Article 106, under the regime of conjugal partnership gains, the husband and wife place in a common fund the fruits, products and fruits and income of their separate properties and those acquired by either or both spouses through their efforts or by chance. No? So yung mga properties nila, kanya-kanya. No? Si Mr. may sariling property, si Mrs. meron din. Yung kuan lang, yung proceeds, products, no fruits, yung kita ng mga separate property nila, yun yung kasama lang no sa yung partnership gains nila. Okay? Then upon dissolution of the marriage or of the partnership, the net gains or benefits obtained by either or both spouses shall be divided equally between them. Net gains, parang kwan talaga, parang negosyo. Kung ano yung mga naiwan na lang, i-divide nila equally. No? Unless otherwise agreed in the marriage settlement. So they can stipulate paano i-divide actually. No? For example, si Mrs., billionaria si Mrs., si Mr. wala masyadong property. No? So conjugal partnership gains sila. No, nakalagay doon kung ano yung contribution ni Mrs., yun yung sharing. Eh kung si Mrs., dahil billionaire siya, 95% of the gains sa kanya, that will be followed, no? Kung that is the agreement in the marriage settlement, no, in relation to yung regime of conjugal partnership of gains. Then you have also yung exclusive property of each spouse. No, they are considered exclusive, which is brought to the marriage as his or her own. No, yung sa kanya talaga yan na property. Those acquired by gratuitous title, dinonate sa kanya. Those acquired by right of redemption, by barter or by exchange with property belonging to only one of the spouses. No, kung exclusive na property, in exchange mo yan, that property is exclusive property also. Number four, that which purchase with exclusive money of the wife or husband. So kung may sarili-sarili silang mga pera, kung anong binili nila dyan, now that will be using that exclusive na money, the property will become exclusive property. Now, under Article 110, the spouses retain the ownership, possession, administration, enjoyment of their exclusive properties. Okay? Then you have yung arrangement. No, sa ng mag-asawa yung tinatawag na regime of separation of property. Meron yan yung mga artista, no, mga politiko. You won't mention name but siguro I'll be giving some ano to classwork na lang yan as part of this presentation. yung regime of separation of property. Kanya-kanya sila. It may refer to present or future property. It may be total or partial. Depende sa pag-uusap nila. In the latter case, the property not agreed upon as separate shall pertain to the absolute community. Kasi kung hindi nakasama yan as separate, then the presumption is that forms part of the absolute community. So ano tong regime of separation of property? Under Article 145 of the Civil Code, no, each or the Family Code, no, each spouse shall own, dispose of, possess, administer, and enjoy his or her own separate estate without need of the consent of the other. Diba, palaging sa atin, when you're into practice of real estate, yung marital consent, always yan, no, na you have almost siguro 99% ng mga transactions, yung marital consent. But baka maka-encounter kayo ng ano to ng mag-asawa na they have separation of property. No? Pinapag-usapan na nila sa marriage settlement nila na oh, we'll be following separation of property. 'Di ba? Parang famous ata ang diyan si ano to, no? Si Senator Kiko, no? And Sharon Cuneta, parang they're following this, no, yung regime of separation of property. Kanya-kanya sila. So, ibig sabihin, kung one spouse, ano yung decision niya, benta niya yung property, there's no need for marital conformity. To each spouse shall belong all earnings from his or her profession, business or industry, and all fruits, natural, industrial, or civil, due or received during the marriage from his or her separate property. Okay, as I mentioned, very rare to, no, in this country, but in other countries, they're slowly gaining ano to, yung being considered as mainstream. Ganun din sa mga gastos sa pang-family, pang-pamilya. No, parang tinitreat nila parang negosyo yung mga gasto sa family, no? Ibig sabihin si Mrs. ganito yung share niya sa expenses. So maglista-lista sila, no, gastos. Okay? Expenses na in proportion to their income or in case of insufficiency or default thereof to the current market value of their separate properties, no? Very tedious na process. Kung malaking income mo, then mas malaking share mo, no, doon sa expenses ng family. The liabilities of the spouses to creditors for a family expenses shall however be solidary. Okay, although individual sila, pero mga gastos, no, naggumastos family expenses, for example, nagbiyahe sila sa ano bang pinaka-expensive na resort in the Philippines? Plus, anybody? Pagkakaalam
nyo? Amanpulo
ba? No? May ko parang mahal sa Amanpulo. For example, no, isang araw, gumastos ng kalahating milyon. No? Tapos they have a 10-day vacation. Yung mag-asawa sa Amanpulo. No? So, 5 million yon, 10 days. No? So, hindi nakapagbayad yung mag-asawa, no, for whatever reason. Yung expenses na yon. No? Yung isa, mas mayaman, yung isa hindi. Ang ibig sabihin ng solidary, obligation, kahit na kanino pwedeng singilin. Hindi pwedeng sabihin ni Mrs. O, kasi mas malaking gastos ni mas malaking kita ni Mr. No, sa provision na to, when you say solidary, pwedeng singilin si Mrs., pwedeng singilin si Mr. Na, that is the meaning of solidary liability. Now, as I mentioned, no, I'll be giving you a short also link, no, presentation of this type of yung relationship. Kasi common to sa real estate practice, tinatanong palagi to. Yung binabahay yung isang partner, yung lalaki binabahay ng babae, o di ba yung babae binabahay ng lalaki, no, yung property regime of unions without marriage. Okay? May na-encounter na ba kayo nito? Plus? No, yung mga live-in lang, live-in. No, the man and a woman, they are capacitated to marry each other. They live exclusively with each other as husband and wife. Wala namang impediment for them not to marry. Nag-live-in lang sila. Na walang benefit of marriage, or kung under a void marriage. No, for example, yung lalaki, panglimang asawa niya na pala yun. So void yung marriage na yon. Ang sabi ng Article 147 ng Family Code, their wages and salary shall be owned by them in equal shares. No? And the property acquired both by them through their work or industry shall be governed by the rules on co-ownership. Civil code na provision, when you say co-ownership, you can prove na ito yung contribution mo. No, yung lahat ng mga properties na acquired yan, they will be covered by the rules on co-ownership. That is the principle of co-ownership. Whatever you contribute, yun yung share mo. Now, that is under Article 147. You have property regime of unions without marriage. So in the absence of proof to the contrary, kung hindi mo mapakita, for example, sabihin mo, ito yung condo, pinili mo to sa pera mo to, no? Tapos nag-live-in lang kayo. Wala kang proof. For whatever reason, hindi mo ma-establish na ang pera manggaling sa'yo, the presumption is yung mga ano to, yung property was obtained by their joint efforts, work, industry, and shall be owned by them in equal shares. Okay, so the presumption, equal shares. No, kung walang proof. Now, may nakalagay din dito, no? May kawawa naman yung partner na walang trabaho. No, for example, si Mrs. yung nagtatrabaho, si Mr. yung naglalaba, no? Si Mr. yung naghahatid ng mga bata. Pero wala naman siyang kita na contribution. Ang sabi dito, a party who did not participate in the acquisition by the other party of any property shall be deemed to have contributed jointly in the acquisition thereof if the former's efforts consisted in the care and maintenance of the family and of the household. So for example, si Mister, sabi niya, ako naman yung naglalaba, ako yung naglilinis ng bahay, no? Wala naman, although totoo naman na wala naman talaga akong contribution dito sa pagbili ng condo, ang sabi ng provision na to, as long as si Mister makapag-prove na siya yung naglalaba, nagluluto, naghatid ng mga bata, that will be considered, no, as his contribution sa ano to, sa acquisition ng property. In fact, under this paragraph, no, neither party can encumber or dispose by acts inter vivos. No, ibig sabihin inter vivos during lifetime of his or her share in the property acquired during cohabitation and owned in common without the consent of the other. Okay, so even sa relationship na ano to, yung live-in, hindi pwedeng ano to, i-dispose yan without the consent of the partner. Hindi na siya marital consent by the partner. So careful tayo diyan, no? Sa real estate, maraming tanong sa akin diyan sa practice. Na yung babae ni live-in, ginawang girlfriend, no? Ang sinabi lang dito na hindi pwedeng sabihin ng ano to, sabihin ng lalaki na oh, hindi ko naman asawa 'yan. No? Because under this provision, hindi niya pwedeng i-dispose 'yan without the consent of his partner. Now, there's a situation when only one of the parties to avoid marriage is in good faith. No, ibig sabihin si Mister, for example, hindi naman si Mister, si partner na guy, no, in bad faith. He represented to the girl na single siya, no, pumayag yung girl, nagstay sila sa condo, no, na binroker ng one of you here in this class. No, so ang question dito eh paano naman to? No, may ano to, may karapatan ba yung girl? No, dahil she was strict into living with that guy. Ang sabi dito, if the party is in bad faith. Are you following me, class?
Yes, sir.
Naintindihan niyo ba yung discussion natin?
Opo.
Nasundan niyo ba? We're discussing this just quickly, no? But we're focusing dito sa other provisions na medyo important. Are you following our discussions?
Opo, sir.
I hope yung makakuha kayo ng relevance dito, no? Baka some of you are into this type of relationship. You can show that the other party is in bad faith, no, forfeit yung share niya. No? The share of the person in bad faith shall be forfeited in favor of their common children. Sa mga anak papunta yung share. Okay? So in case of default, each vacant share shall belong to the respective surviving descendants. No? So kung wala namang descendants, ang sabi ng batas, papunta yan sa innocent party. Okay? For example, nag-away-away na sila, na-discover ng girl na yung lalaki pala, maraming partners, no? So bad faith siya. So ang sinasabi, the share of the party in bad faith, no, in that co-ownership relationship may be forfeited in favor of the common children. Kung walang anak, papunta sa yung innocent na party. Okay, after that, no, let's discuss quickly naman yung constitutional provisions involving property ownership. So you have classification of lands of the public domain. You can find that in Article 12, Section 3. Now it states that lands of the public domain are classified into 1. Agricultural, 2. Forest or timber, 3. Is mineral lands, and 4. National parks. No, take note yung order niyan, yung classification. No, when I was reviewing before, event sequence, titingnan ko yan eh. No, may mnemonics dito is AFM, no, AFM, the national parks. Ganun yung preparation ko before when I was preparing for the board exams. So agricultural lands of the public domain may be further classified by law according to the uses to which they may be devoted. So yung mga further classification ng mga lupa, galing yan sa yung main classification na agricultural. No? So from agricultural, meron siyang reclassification, no, into residential, commercial, industrial, no, and other uses. Take note, Article 12, Section 3. Ownership of lands of public domain. So ito, dito na nanggaling yung regalian doctrine. No, but we discussed, no, before midterms yung exception sa regalian doctrine, no, yung mga ancestral lands. But generally, no, we follow yung regalian doctrine. Under Article 12, Section 2, it states that all lands of the public domain, waters, minerals, coal, petroleum, and other mineral oil, all forces of potential energy, no, yung araw, yung tubig, wind, no, fisheries, forests, or timber, wildlife, flora, and fauna, and other natural resources are owned by the state. So yung hangin na sa labas ng mga bahay natin, araw, no, yung ulan na nahuhulog sa kalangitan, no, natural resources yan, they're owned by the state. Okay, so kaya kung maglagay ka ng mga solar projects mo, no, you cannot say that, oh, galing kasi sa kanyan, araw, no, hindi sinabi dito by our Article 12, Section 2, by virtue of the regalian doctrine, those, no, all forces of potential energy, they're owned by the state. With the exception of agricultural lands, all other natural resources shall not be alienated. So only agricultural lands are susceptible of alienation. All other natural resources, they cannot be alienated without the permission or consent of the state or government. So as we mentioned kanina, no, alienable lands of the public domain shall be limited to agricultural lands. So let's have a quick review. Now, I'm sure na-cover niyo na to. Let's just have a quick review on ownership of lands. The general rule is ownership of lands are reserved only to Filipinos, no, including those who availed of dual citizenship. Okay, owner, that's the general rule. Kasama na yung mga dual citizens, no? They can own lands, no, obviously. But may mga exceptions tayo. What are those exceptions? Number one, acquisition of foreigners before the 1935 Constitution. No? Kasi before 1935, we were under the American regime. Philippines is considered as part of American territory. So those foreigners who acquired property before 1935, they're allowed, no, to own these lands or property. Pangalawa, acquisition of foreigners by hereditary succession. No, take note, nakalimutan natin to. No, yung foreigners, they can acquire by hereditary succession. For example, anak sila, no, ng isang Pilipino. Although they are foreigners, but by virtue of this provision, they can own lands in the Philippines, no, by hereditary succession. Then ito yung common na sa practice natin, purchase of foreigners of not more than 40% of a condominium project. No? Take note, not more than 40% of the condominium project or not more than 40% of a realty corporation or partnership. So maganda rin to sa practice. No? You know, merong karapatan yung mga foreigners, you can structure yung deal na compliant with this requirement. No? So binibilang yan yung mga number of units. No, minomonitor din yan, for example, the number of units, 100 units, no, theoretically, yung foreigners can own 40 units, no, in that condominium project. Or not more than 40% of a realty corporation, so mag-issue ka ng shares of stock, not more than 40% can be owned by foreigners or yung isang partnership. Then several times, no, lumabas sa board exam natin as an exception, yung purchase by former natural born Filipinos. No, former natural born Filipinos, pinanganak sila na Pilipino, then later na nawala yung citizenship nila, they are still given that privilege or right to own lands in the Philippines by virtue of or subject to the limitations under Batas Pambansa Bilang 185 and Republic Act number 8179. Na-cover niyo to, class? Batas Pambansa Bilang 185 at saka Republic Act number 8179?
Yes po, attorney.
Okay, so quickly, no, i-review natin to, no, quickly lang for your mastery. No, so land ownership by Filipinos galing abroad, no? So ito yung mga Pinoy, as we mentioned, they were born Filipinos, tapos nawala yung citizenship nila. Ang sabi lang, under Article 12, Section 8, na they can be a transferee of private lands subject to limitations provided by law. So ito na yung na-mention natin kanina, no, yung Batas Pambansa 185 at saka Republic Act 8179. I-discuss natin to in the succeeding slides. What are these? Ano to yung provisions under these laws? So take note, the coverage here, they are natural born Filipinos who have lost their Philippine citizenship. By constitutional provision, they can still own subject to limitations provided by law. So let's discuss, no, yung ownership of Filipinos. They can be based abroad, no, normally. The laws on land ownership by Filipinos overseas are contained in, as we mentioned earlier, Batas Pambansa Bilang 185 and Republic Act 8179, which amended the Foreign Investment Act of 1985. It stipulates guidelines on land ownership by former Filipinos for purposes of establishing residence. Now, BP 185 for purposes of establishing residence, while Section 10 of Republic Act 8179 specifies entitlements and conditions for land acquisition for investment purposes. So let's make it very clear, no? Sa BP 185, ang purpose ng right, no, given to former Filipinos for purposes of establishing residence here in the Philippines. While Republic Act 8179, it specifies entitlements and conditions for land acquisition for investment purposes. So being a transferee, no, it can be, it refers to a voluntary or involuntary sale, device or donation. So pwedeng for example, nag-auction sale, no, foreclosure, yung mga former Filipinos, no, natural born Filipinos, they can acquire these properties, no. Yung when you say involuntary sale, they include sales on tax delinquency. Now, for example, hindi ka nakapagbayad ng real property tax natin. No, may computation tayo niya next week. Hindi ka nakapagbayad, pwedeng ibenta yung property mo on tax delinquency. Foreclosures. Hindi ka nakapagbayad ng utang na foreclosure yung property, yung mga former Filipinos, natural born Filipinos, they can be awardees, no, or they can bid during auction. For executions of judgment, mga husgado, yung mga kaso-kaso niyan, tapos i-benta ng sheriff during auction sale. No, yung slide na to saying that yung mga former Filipinos, they can bid, no, during auction. Yung dalawang laws na to, no, because they're frequently asked during the board exams, they define former Filipinos as citizens of the Philippines from birth without having to perform any act to acquire or perfect their Philippine citizenship. Yung pinanganak ka na Pilipino. Pinanganak ka na Pilipino, but eventually you lost your Philippine citizenship. Nagtrabaho ka abroad. O for example, gusto mo talaga magpa-change ng citizenship. But under this law, no, you are still considered former Filipino, of course, no, na entitled ka to some benefit under our constitution. You can be a transferee of lands, or you can acquire lands, no, by virtue of yung dalawang law that we mentioned, BP 185 at saka Republic Act 8179. But they have a legal capacity to enter into contract under Philippine laws. Let's dissect, no? BP 185 saka RA, originally this is RA 7252 as amended by Republic Act 8179. No? Kung tanungin kayo sa board exam, bago naging Republic Act 8179 yan, originally it's Republic Act 7252. We're making comparison, no, sa dalawang provisions of law. Yung ano yung mga sizes, area, at saka coverage. Under BP na, discuss nyo to class, yung mga areas under your foundation courses.
No po,
yes po, attorney.
Yes, yes,
okay,
po.
So let's emphasize, no, yung area na to. Under BP 185, 1,000 square meters for urban land. For rural land, it's 1 hectare. So for residence purposes, no, malaki-laki na rin to. Now, if you want to establish residence, pwede, no, under BP 185, you can acquire. Now, for investment purposes, up to 5,000 square meters. For those Filipinos, no, Filipinos na who lost their citizenship. So, no need na mag-dual. No need na mag-dual kasi yung iba, nag-a-advise sa mga Filipinos na, oh, mag-dual ka. And no need na mag-dual ka if you're a former Filipino or you are natural born Filipino. If you want to acquire land here in the Philippines, no need to have that ano to, yung hassle na mag-apply ka pa ng dual citizenship. Kung ang target mo lang naman is just 5,000 square meters of urban land, malaki-laki nito, kalahating hektarya. Or if you want to invest sa provinces, up to 3 hectares of rural land. Gusto mong magbakasyon sa Pilipinas, meron kang farm, you just acquire 3 hectares. Malaki-laki na rin yan, no, na you can enjoy. No need for you to be a dual citizen, no, because of these provisions under Republic Act 7242 as amended by Republic Act 8179. Sinong pwede mag-avail? Kung pareho kayong former Filipino, Filipino, natural-born Filipinos, either spouses may avail. As long as you don't exceed the area limit. Pareho din sa Republic Act 8179. No? Pwede silang mag-acquire as long as the area, no? Counted yon. Counted yon sa, as yung sizes, counted yon sa, ano to, sa mag-asawa. No? For example, residential area under BP 185, ang pwede nilang si Mr. Nag-acquire ng 700 square meters, pwede pang si Mrs. mag-acquire ng 300. No? That is yung limitation if they are spouses. So that is yung mga additional acquisition. May limit, no? So ang limit applies to spouses. Of course, kung yung spouse hindi natural born Filipino, hindi applicable yon. No, hindi applicable of course because foreigners are not allowed, no, to own property here in the Philippines unless yung sa isang condominium project. Diba, investment sa isang realty corporation or partnership. Pwede rin mag-acquire ng dalawang kuan. No? Ang requirement under both laws, no? Yung BP 185 at saka RA 8179, maximum 2 lots lang. No? Pwedeng different municipalities or cities anywhere in the Philippines. As long as hindi ka na, you don't exceed the area. No? Yung area na coverage, hindi mo sobrahan. No, again, under BP 185, the limit is 1,000 square meters for urban land. Pagkatapos, 1 hectare for rural land. Again, under BP 185, the purpose is for residence. Now, contrast that with Republic Act 8179, the purpose is for business or investment. No? So, 5,000 urban, 3 hectares, no, for rural land. Kung mag-asawa, pwede as long as hindi nila ma-exceed yung ceiling. If they want to acquire properties in different areas, pwede ang requirement, there's a limit up to only 2 lots. For example, si Mr. taga Batanes, si Mrs. taga Tawit at taga Hulo, no? Pwede nilang, pwede, they can acquire, no? They can acquire, si Mr. can acquire, ano to, acquire kung rural area, 1 hectare sa Batanes, si Mrs. naman can acquire 2 hectares pagdating sa Tawi-Tawi. But kung magdagdag sa ng third lot, that is not allowed anymore, no? Because the limitation, the restriction is, dapat hindi susobra sa dalawang lote anywhere in the Philippines. Clear? Class? Clear yon? No, may lumabas sa board exam na ganyan na ano to, mga limit-limit, no, pangpalito dito. But take note palagi na dapat hindi sumobra sa dalawang lote. Nakalagay dito, an individual who has already acquired urban land shall be disqualified from acquiring rural land and vice versa. Ha? So dapat pipili ka, no? So kung nag-acquire ka ng urban land, yun yung mag-apply sa iyo, no? You cannot acquire both, no? So dapat kung ano yung urban land mo, for example, nag-apply ka ng 1,000, you cannot acquire 5,000, no, na rural land. So that is the under Batas Pambansa 185, no, for residential purposes. So there's a restriction, that once you opted, for example, you opted for rural land, you cannot acquire another for urban land. Under Republic Act 8179, no, in particular under Section 4, no, a transferee who has already acquired urban land shall be disqualified from acquiring rural land and vice versa. Okay? So there's a limitation. Pipili ka anong ba talagang i-acquire mo? Will you be acquiring urban land for investment purposes or for rural land, no, for investment purposes? Kasi under this Republic Act 8179, bawal din, hindi pwede. So for example, you decided to acquire urban land, no, invoking your right as a former natural born Filipino, no, by virtue of your constitutional provision as well as Republic Act 8179, you cannot say na you cannot claim the benefit of acquiring both urban at saka yung rural land, no? So either lang, pipili ka nung gusto mong piliin, mag rural or urban.
However,
if the transferee has disposed of his or her urban land, she may still acquire rural land. No? So ang isang remedy mo kung gusto mong isang klase, no, you want na ayaw mo na yung urban land mo pero may rural land ka, ang remedy is for you is just to dispose it. Okay? To dispose it. Tapos you acquire other type of land. So there's a limitation here, no? There's a limitation here. Kung ano yung purpose ng acquisition mo, for example, under BP 185, for residential purposes, hindi mo pwedeng gawing pang negosyo. That's the limitation. The limitation because you only avail of the provision under BP 185 for residential purposes. So ang question, can you acquire for example residential dito na pala yung sagot no? Under this slide, no, under Republic Act 8179, pwede ka pang mag-acquire, no? For example, you acquired residential land under Batas Pambansa 185, you can still avail of the privilege granted under this law, under Republic Act 8179, no, for business purposes. So you can still avail of the benefit, no? So pwedeng dalawa, pwede mong i-avail. Under Section 5 of Rule 12, it specifically states that the land should be primarily, directly, and actually used in the performance of conduct of the owner's business or commercial activities in the broad areas of agriculture, na ito yung pwede mong pasukan, industry and services, including the lease of land, but excluding the buying and selling thereof. Okay? So, pwede mong iparent. Yung property because you acquired the property by virtue of RA 8179. At hindi kasama dyan yung buying and selling thereof, no? Kasi kung benta mo yan, then you will be losing yung benefit, no, under Republic Act 8179. Ano ba mga additional requirements? No, additional requirements, yan, no? The transferee should submit to the register of deeds of the province or city where the property is located a sworn statement stating the following. In addition to the requirements under BP 185, yung mga requirements, sworn statement, date and place of birth, no, names and address of your parents, spouse and children, area, location and mode of acquisition of land holdings in the Philippines, if any, and your intention to reside permanently in the Philippines. Then you have to disclose also the date that you lost your Philippine citizenship and the country of which he or she is presently a citizen. That is under Batas Pambansa 185. Under Republic Act 8179, no, and yung mga requirements, no, and dito yung checklist of requirements. So the same then yung mga sworn statement stating the information required under Batas Pambansa 185. Then in addition to that, certification from the assessor of the municipality or province where the property is situated and the subject land for transfer is an urban or rural area. Okay, you have a certification from DAR that the land is agricultural, it's a retention area of the transferor, and an affidavit of the transferee attesting that, his or total landholding inclusive of the land to be acquired does not exceed 5 hectare limit provided under Republic Act 6657. Na yung limit natin sa under Republic Act 6657. No, what is the Republic Act 6657? This is the CARP law, no, the Comprehensive Agrarian Reform Law. Previous years, palaging tinatanong yan. No? So kung matanong na yan, that should be a giveaway na. No? Dapat makuha natin yan. No, RA 6657. So limit, no, just a quick summary. Limit on real property ownership up to 12 hectares by purchase, homestead or grant, and up to 5 hectares under the CARP law. These are constitutional provisions on limitation on property ownership here in the Philippines. We have yung constitutional list limitations. Do you have private corporations or associations? Now, without foreign ownership restrictions, they may lease not more than, they may lease not more than 1,000 hectares for a period of 25 years, renewable for another 25 years. Okay, mga private corporations, they want to engage into some for project, no, pending, they can engage into this arrangement for 1,000 hectares, no, for a period of 25 years, renewable for another 25 years. Then Filipinos may lease up to 500 hectares. Kung individuals naman, we may lease up to 500 hectares subject to the Civil Code maximum limitation of 99 years. Okay, so kung tingnan natin, actually, kung for business purposes, kung if you want to save on your capital, there's no need to acquire, no, yung property, you may have yung long-term lease, no, subject to your right to terminate the lease then under certain conditions. So yung limit ng lease for Filipinos, up to 500 hectares, up to 99 years. Then you have yung statutory lease limitations. The maximum term of a lease of land to non-Philippine nationals, no, mga non-Filipinos, is 25 years, renewable for another 25 years. That is by virtue of Presidential Decree number 471. Then under certain conditions, you have covered this class, yung statutory lease limitations. You have covered this ba?
Attorney, sa legal namin
po. Okay, so you have also yung Investors Lease Act na under Republic Act number 7652. The lease may be for a term of 50 years. So it deviated from the standard na 25 years under the Investors Lease Act or Republic Act number 7652. The lease may be for a term of 50 years, ganun katagal. No, renewable for another 25 years. Okay, this applies to yung tinatawag nating mga lease, no? Statutory lease limitations which non-Filipinos may consider, no, instead of acquiring property or buying property, then they may consider entering into a long-term lease arrangement. Okay, so that ends my lecture, no? Very quick review on fundamentals of property ownership.